that led us then to talking about really a very interesting area, soft tissue and dinosaur bones, which is with Kevin Anderson, and we went down to Arizona. Which that was an exciting area for you. I know you were very, this is one of the more fascinating areas, I think, for most people. They're fascinated. They're not unaware of this.
No, I mean, the opportunity to go into the lab with Dr. Kevin Anderson, but his explanation of how that material, the protein in that material, breaks down rapidly. It's not something that survives a long period of time. And in particular, as he was saying, in the hostile environment in which these things are found, and the fact that we're now finding it in other bones. That's a paradigm shift for people who would have never, ever have considered finding soft dinosaur tissue. And so we weren't looking for it.
Right.
And now that we're looking for it, well, we're finding this is not an anomaly. This is not a one-off. They even find it in rib bones, smaller rib
bones.
That's
right. Yeah. So I found that was interesting because when he originally did this work, he worked with Mark Armitage, who did all the microscopy work. And Mark is an electron microscopist who found this. In fact, that's where all of our video footage came from, was Mark, who was doing the microscopy work out of California. And Kevin, who was doing a lot of the analysis and kind of talking through some of the ways these things could actually potentially have been preserved. And I think that's an interesting point. I don't know if it came out, but the original work had been done by Mary Schweitzer, who is a very respected and very smart paleontologist, but because of her, I think it's her histone, she'd run blood work, she saw and knew what this was, working with Jack Horner, who's actually one of the guys who had advised on Jurassic Park, ironically enough. But Mary Schweitzer knew what she had found, that it either, now of course Mary Schweitzer has embraced and has held onto the paradigm, and understandably so, of an old Earth, and therefore buys into the radioisotope dating, saying that, well, they've got to be old. Mm-hmm. And so she's looking for what is the mechanism, but that's the problem, is that what was fascinating is when you look at the psychology of the speakers, people who, and Kevin gets into this later in the interview, that they rejected this out of hand, and said, someone actually said to one of these folks who was looking at this, who had said, well, it's bacteria, well, it's bird dropping, well, it's someone's lunch, I mean, all kind of bizarre things were told to her, criticizing her. And someone once said, was asking, well, what would it take for you to believe that this was really dinosaur tissue? And he said, nothing. Nothing. It reminds me of Stephen Gould saying, well, I'm just not going to go there.
That's right.
And because they understood it. Well, what's fascinating when you get into this is people who withdrew views that said, well, I only know these proteins could last, 100,000, a million years, and they just have stopped talking about it. She's done a lot of work in the iron model to try to say, okay, we're going to take ostrich vessels and let's preserve them in an iron. The problem I always had with this is like, well, that's not how they were found. And this idea of, and then what no one seemed to talk about is radiation. That the levels of uranium and thorium in the soil, I think there's a scientist that talks about this, you can put, apparently, I've done this, a Geiger counter up against many fossils bones, and it lights up. Meaning, if, and let's just take the paradigm, it really is 65 million years old, well, the amount of uranium and thorium and all the things that we know, we often have people getting radon, just checking in our own homes, so we don't want the levels, that's all in there. So basically, the idea of gamma rays and beta waves that will be going through and destroying this tissue for 65, 75 million years, that's really extraordinary. Right. And no one has explained how, what is it, lead encased now too, and what is this? Mm-hmm. And then you have the reality of how they're found, and there's so much of them. Now, I think Kevin's right. It's very hard to understand even how in 5 and 6,000 years this would be. It's reasonable.
Right, even from near term.
Why would it even be there near term? But I think it's very curious with all this curious things going on radiologically during the flood and the things happening. There's something there potentially. Some reasoning that I think that the creationists will likely have better models to explain this eventually. Yeah.
And this also brings us back again to the paradigms and the power of paradigms, because not only does this lie outside of a deep time paradigm, you would never predict, you would never expect, and even after it's happened, you would deny, you'd say somebody's lunch, that it doesn't fit in there. Well, then that also leads us to understand why, I think it was Dr. Anderson who was telling us, that for years and years, the published reports was that there was no radiocarbon in those bones. Well, when they went back and looked at the raw data, they said there was, because now
they have to get. Mm-hmm.
Well, what happens?
They're adjusting them. Everything gets adjusted to a standard because they're like, well, there can't be radiocarbon in it, so if we're getting it, it's not there.
So it's an anomaly. it doesn't fit, and so forth, so it doesn't get reported. And so it's not out of meanness. It's just that
it's
doesn't. It's something weird, and so and so now we go back and say, well, my goodness, now there's radiocarbon in here, which shouldn't be there.
You That's
know,
correct.
Especially if you're talking about moons, you know, 60, 70, 80 millions of years, by that radiocarbon has such a small half-life, mm-hmm. it should be gone. But it isn't. And so now we have soft dinosaur tissue, we have radiocarbon in there, which is saying that these may not be as old as what we've been told. And so all of a sudden, these are one of those anomalies. This is the anomalies piling up.
Correct. One after the other.
That begin to shake a paradigm.
Well, it is, and I think that the important thing here is to realize that it isn't that one believes based on the data. One believes the paradigm first and then begins to look at the data, but some paradigms will be better fit by other data, just as history shows us that there are some paradigms that really are fairly weak, even though they may be functional for a period of time. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I think right. that's a fair thing to say about the Darwinian paradigm. It wasn't that it was all wrong and everything. I don't think it is. I think that it's not nearly as accurate a view mm-hmm. as the creation view.
No,
and it leaves many things out, right. and that there's some smart people who are sure. very worth, done wonderful work. And I love reading. To be honest, Donald Prothero, I love reading his stuff. He hates creationists. I love his books. Because I think he's a scientist that's really interested in these things. Stephen Jay Gould, I can go down the list of secular scientists I like to read, seeing through them, through how they talk about the data and knowing, oh, well, this could be looked at this way, and you're just spinning it this way. Now, I don't spin on the right word, interpreting it that way. Mm-hmm. Sometimes more validly than others.
No, it's just like somebody who studies heat in air. And we study it, and we realize, because in our homes we know that when air heats up, it rises to the top. Well, that's true. It's not. You're not stupid. You see it. You can tell that. But if all of a sudden you then say, well, then if we go to the top of the Himalayas, it's going to be really hot up there. When all of a sudden we find that that doesn't work. Well, it's an anomaly. And so we figure out, okay, why is that the case if hot air rises? And the same is true with ice. You know, that as water gets colder and colder, it gets denser and denser. Well, if you study it in a small section, that's really true. And that's exactly what happened. And water, as it gets colder and colder, it sinks to the bottom. But then as it begins to solidify, it changes and it begins to float. Thankfully, otherwise we'd have life
fish.
Couldn't exist
right.
because ice would be on the bottom. But it's what happens when a paradigm all of a sudden begins to get data outside of its range. It's not that there's something wrong with your study here. It's not that you don't understand heat and cold temperatures and how it applies to the molecular activity of water, but you understood it within a particular range, and now all of a sudden it begins to change. And now we have the same situation. You know, now
well, it is. But I think that the issue here in terms of the empirical data stuff and then historical science is an important distinction. And that's really what we try to do with these first sections, starting from Mount St. Helens and going all the way to soft tissue. That's really our first part of the film, if you will, where you deal with the geology and you deal with the catastrophe. And it's this idea that the geological sciences are historical sciences. So you can't go do any of these experiments
right.
exactly the same
True.
Way. Right. And the paradigm that's driving it is reinterpreting all of this historical data. And so what I wanted to demonstrate is that catastrophe and large flood events and the text and the fossil record and all of the materials inside those, they all fit in a one, you can look at them together and realize, well, there's actually a lot, a consilience, if you will, a jumping together of things that make a lot of sense with this biblical history.
Right.
And furthermore, it's a history that's now being put against a history, the natural history. Mm-hmm. And it goes back to that paradigm that this is not about philosophies, essentially. It's about adopted a history.
Right.
Right. And that's really what that first section is that, mm-hmm. that I feel like the soft tissue basically is the nail in the coffin. In my opinion, that we've established all these points and it's like, okay, let's just shut this lid. I don't think this is the best accurate view of history because time comes from the rocks. It doesn't come from anywhere else. It comes from the rocks based on this earth. And we're not talking about the heavens right now, but if you're on the earth, it's on the rocks.